Guys, I got a remote up here to advance your slides. Okay. Tim, are we live yet? Or
we are recording on Zoom.
Okay. Well, welcome everybody virtually. We'll get going here in just a minute. Waiting on one more speaker to show up.
Yeah. Tim,
okay. He's coming. Well, let me go ahead and start on the intro. First off, welcome to the 13th Waste Conversion Technology Conference. My name is Gene Jones. I'm the executive director for a small nonprofit in Tallahassee, Florida called the Southern Waste Information Exchange. My 30-second elevator pitch is we basically assist industries and municipalities with waste issues. We kind of act like a clearinghouse for information, as well as foster. I'm a matchmaker. I put waste generators in touch with waste users. Part of what we do is to put on conferences in the environmental arena, mainly in recycling, waste management. We run this particular conference, the Southeast Recycling Conference, Agricultural Plastic Recycling Conference, which usually we do in conjunction with this event. This year we're taking a break. And then also we do some remediation conferences. If you allow me, I'm going to make a couple of opening comments. First off, if I could get everybody, including myself, put their phones on vibrate. And then let me just kind of tell everybody, all the presentations that you're going to see, we are, of course, recording this via Zoom. We're going to take all the presentations and convert them to a PDF document and then make that available to everybody post-event. The other thing that we will make available is the list of attendees. Now, if you are just a regular registrant, you're going to get the names and affiliations for everybody. If anybody in the room does not want their name released, please let me know at some point prior to the conclusion of the conference. All our sponsors, exhibitors, and VIP registrants are going to get the full database with contact information. So again, if you don't want your name on that list, please let me know. Bathrooms are out over across the walkway in the other building. So if you need to use the restroom, that's where you're going to need to go. All our breaks are going to be in the exhibit hall. We've got a reception tonight from, 5:30 to 7, I believe. If you have any problems, please see myself, my wife Dana, Dennis, or TJ is in the back of the room. So with that, let me just kind of go through a couple of things. First off, this conference would not be possible, I can promise you that, without our sponsors. So BMH Technology and then Geica Environmental have contributed on the gold level sponsors, and then our silver sponsors are Juno, Energy Transaction Advisors, the Caprizi Europa, it's a baling company, that baling manufacturing company, and then Recycling Today. And then our contributing folks that help us get the word out about the event is Team California, Resource Recycling, Imperial Valley Economic Development Agency, and American Recycler. So again, thank you for all of our sponsors to help us get the word out. Real quickly, next year, I know I've already had a couple of questions saying, are we going to be back here next year in San Diego? I love doing this event out here. I'm from Florida, and in August, it is much better to be out here than be in Florida in the heat. But next year, we are actually going to hold this event in conjunction with SWANA's SOAR division. And we're going to have Tim Flanagan tell us a little bit more about that here in just a few minutes. So I think there's a great opportunity to expand what it is that we're doing, to get the word out about conversion technologies. You know, one of the problems we've had as industry, Tim, come on up. Within the industry, with conversion technologies, is being able to, what I call, kick the tires, right? We hear about these conversion technologies taking place in Europe and Asia. Really haven't had that many successful commercial projects up until now, and you're going to hear from a couple of them during the course of this conference. There are some great projects that are taking place on a commercial scale, and I'm delighted to see that it is slowly starting to advance, and we're going to see more of that here in the next year or two. I will mention, I was just talking to Gene Cogan just a little while ago prior to us me coming up here, and he mentioned about the infrastructure bill and advised me to pay attention because there's evidently going to be some funding for this whole community down the road. So it's something we all need to pay attention of. In fact, if we can, I will host a webinar on it. And once, fingers crossed, the bill passes, we'll make that available and try to get the word out to everybody. So pay attention to emails. Yes, sir. No, I'm going to do, I'll probably do ag film in conjunction. I don't know if I'm going to do it in 23 or I'm going to wait and do it in conjunction with NPE. I want to reach back out to them. They're back in Orlando in 24. We did the ag plastic conference in conjunction with NPE, I think around 2018, I think. So we may do it in that because that's, you know, 10,000 people that we would have a better access to. So with that, I'm going to get off the stage and turn it over to Glen Tobiason. I have to praise Glen, and there's a couple of you in the room that have been here year in and year out to support this whole industry, and Glen is one of them. I highly appreciate his advice and guidance for the industry and his input towards the conference. So Glen, I'm going to let you drive the show. It is all yours, sir. All right.
Oh, let me make one other quick introduction.
One thing, we do have one speaker change. David Wilkinson is not able to join us. He was going to be speaking on funding waste conversion projects. I sent an email out to everybody just a little while ago. We did a pre-recorded, his talk on pre-recorded. So you do have that. And then we've got Jim Phillips, who's with True North Renewable Energy, is going to be taking that slot and going to be talking about what's going on out here in California on anaerobic digestion and organic waste. So with that, Glen, all yours.
So also, good morning. Just a quick thing, Glen Tobias from InnoWaCon. I was also in Germany, so I do speak German, so I think we'll do this whole conference in German. Is that right? You like that idea?
Jawohl.
Is that a good idea? Jawohl? Yeah, we're good. We're good right there. And there's also a few Germans in the room. No, it will be in English. Don't worry about that. I have the honor to welcome our first speakers today. I really like this job, and it's going to be very, very interesting today and tomorrow with our whole schedule of events and speakers. I think the waste conversion is right now very interesting in the U.S., in North America. What's happening, if you also look at the monies that are coming out of the government right now in different areas, we can surely take use of those, make use of that money to further our needs and cause and the environmental aspects of it. So let's do it. If there are any questions, I think after each speaker, I think there's a short time for questions and answers, so not during the speech, but right after that, before we get to the next speaker, if we can have that. And is there a microphone also to be brought around in case someone has to speak? Okay. Good, very good. So let me introduce first, Waste in the Spotlight, Creating Opportunities in Many Different Ways. That's Tim Flanagan, Project Manager of SCS Engineers and also President of SWANA. I think there'll be some very interesting information coming out of that. So no further ado, Tim, please come on up.
There's the clicker, okay. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for being here. So, again, I'm Tim Flanagan, Project Director at SES. That's my day job, but I'm really here as the president of SWANA, and in that capacity, welcome you there. So maybe I'd start off with a couple of questions. Is who in the audience here today is under the age of 40? Raise your hand. All right. So it's very sobering for me to know that I've been in the industry longer than you have been alive. So that's sort of the sobering note. And the other thing is maybe who in the audience is a member, and you notice I didn't raise my hand when I said under 40, but this one I can raise my hand. Who in the audience is a member of SWANA? Raise your hand. Okay, so there's some opportunities there. So I'm here today to kick off your conference. Thank you all for coming to San Diego. I think you'll enjoy it here. And the topic today is Waste in the Spotlight, Opportunities Now. And this conversation between private sector players and the public sector is increasingly powerful. We're now developing this. Hence the topic, Waste in the Spotlight. Now more than ever, I think our industries are in the spotlight, in the attention for how we help battle global climate change. And I think all of us in the room, and you'll hear me talk about this a little bit, my presentation today, should feel really good that we are in an industry that is trying to do something impactful around the climate. And we're making great strides in response to that. SWANA, the Solid Waste Association of North America, if those of you that don't know, there's a number here. It's an 11,000 member organization. We cover Canada, the United States, the Caribbean, Western Pacific. And our members know what being in the spotlight talks about being heard and being recognized. And over the last few years, we've been very, very effective in getting Washington, which really hadn't paid much attention to our industry, as you know, for many years, to pay attention to us and to listen to what we have to say as an industry. And over the last several years, SWANA has emerged as part of the authority that helps media, government agencies, vendors outreach when they need information. And we've had the ability to brief Congress, get in front of committees, get in front of the EPA and the various departments to let them know that our industry is out there and we could use their help. And more importantly, we have something to offer to bring to the table because we can help reduce and lower our greenhouse gas emissions. But as you think about it, we have an interesting track in our industry. And if you think about how far technology has come along, hopefully this graphic will help illustrate that. You think, you know, my sense is demand accelerates the development curve. So when I started, if you look back on the graphic here, in the 70s, all we had was a phone on the desk, right? Who of us remember a phone on the desk, right? Okay. And then, if you think our industry has sort of patterned that growth, and particularly the waste diversion and reuse opportunities have followed that demand growth. So you see, that's meant to be a brick phone. I had a brick phone, you know, like Sonny Crockett in Miami Vice, right? You had one of those. Then we had the flip phone, right? And then we moved into the BlackBerry, right? Everybody had those in the 2000s. And now, your phones that you have in your hands, if you think about it, that phone is a computer more powerful than what landed the men on the moon. That's pretty crazy when you think about that. When I started back in the industry, there were maybe 36 curbside recycling programs in the entire United States, entirely. But what do we have now? Our industry has grown. That rapid pace has grown. So now we don't even think about it. Maybe folks in the room remember the Mobro garbage barge? You remember that? It wandered off the coast, East Coast, in the late 80s. Yeah, didn't have a home, had a bunch of bales on it, couldn't find a place. Well, that kind of kick-started the whole thought process about what are we doing? What is a more responsible way to deal with our waste? And in California, it led to the development of a very dramatic piece of legislation called AB 939, which directed all jurisdictions to divert up to 50% of their waste stream by the year 2000. And a number of programs were jump-started here in California as a result of that. And as you'll hear more discussion this week, and again, thank you for being here this week, you'll hear about SB 1383, which really isn't a waste diversion bill, it's a climate change bill, targeting organics and their diversion from the landfill. And you'll hear several presenters this week talk about opportunities for organics, opportunities that in the spectrum of waste conversion. Paralleling the cell phone, we've seen the changes in our industry and that technology drives innovation. The rear loader truck that you see there, when I first went to work for the city of Palo Alto, I volunteered to go with a private collector for 2 weeks on the back of a truck to help pick up garbage. I was very young, I was in my 20s, and I'll tell you, after the first day, I was almost dead. It was backyard service. You had to get a big metal can on your back, put it on your back, put the garbage in, run it out to the curb. Well, those guys weren't slowing down for me, so they were about three or four houses ahead of me trying to catch up. And the next day when I came in and my shoulder was killing me, they were very gracious. They made a little pad for me with towels and duct tape, so I had it under my shoulder and went through there. That gave me a lot of respect for what the women and men in this industry do. And as a result, we've emerged and we've improved the technology. So that now you can see in the picture on the right, that is a fully automated collection truck. But not only that, if you notice on the top, those are CNG tanks. And now we're running on a lower intense fuel. And where I came from before I joined SCS, the Monterey Regional Waste Management District, we're actually taking our landfill gas, converting that into vehicle fuel, and we built a truck yard for a local franchise hauler. So they're running on RNG fuel from our landfill converted right into their tank. So if you think about it, that's a pretty amazing concept, that what you pick up goes right back, and that's what we're talking about in a circular economy, that their waste that they deliver here is being generated into their fuel. Our recycling and technical division, as we can see here, there's Sustainable Materials Management Division. I was the technical director for them for a few years. And that SWANA is working with the EPA to advance the areas of recycling. SWANA is partnering with the EPA on EPA's national recycling strategy. And I'm going to read these particular bills that we've worked very hard to get done. And one is the Solid Waste Infrastructure and Recycling Grant Program. Another is the Recycling Education and Outreach Grant Program, Model Recycling Program Toolkit in School Curriculum. And one of the third initiatives is the Battery Collection Best Practices and Voluntary Laboring Guidelines. We work with the EPA and their EPA Task Force to set that 50% goal by the year 2030. And we're happy to say there's going to be $75 million in funding available in the late fall. Leachate, PFAS. This is talking about industry potential. The EPA is evaluating whether or not to label PFAS as a hazardous substance under Superfund. For any of us that have landfills or support landfills, that's very critical. That allows you to go back past liability, retroactive liability, if you have those in your landfill. That would be a very, very, very expensive proposition. So the NWRA, the National Waste Recycling Association, and SWANA are working in Washington to try and get a carve out an exemption for that. But more often, and you'll see some of these presentations, I think, here this week, is that this gives an incredible business opportunity for how to deal and destruct PFAS. So I think you'll hear more of this come along in development. This isn't going away. This is a huge potential liability that's handing itself to us here. And I think this is one where we'll see more development. On safety, SWANA is working, and you may not know this, but the industry, solid waste industry, is the sixth most dangerous job occupation in the United States. That's not a top 10 list you want to be on. And as you know, in our divisions that we have, we're going to focus to integrate that safety message along with our other technical opportunities that we have. We're working with Congress and OSHA to go through this. We're facilitating a discussion with OSHA to create a safety alliance, about a battery task force that is with NWRA and other stakeholders to work on reducing the impacts of batteries. I myself and the facilities that I've run have personally experienced battery explosions and fires. You can read in the news, there's been a number of facilities that have literally burned down because of the impact of lithium batteries in the waste stream. And this is one where we really need to push for something along the line of product producer responsibility to get these materials diverted away. I think we all know that batteries exploding in a facility don't do very well for us. And we've had a couple of major incidents around that. Where SWANA aligns itself with, for instance, this division and this technical conference, and as we heard, we'll be partnered together next year in Atlanta. We have a waste conversion and energy recovery technical division. We organize ourselves around several technical divisions. I should have mentioned that at the front end. We have 47 chapters in SWANA and 7 technical divisions. So they represent different areas of interest in the solid waste area: landfills, landfill gas, collection and transfer, sustainable materials management, and this division, which is germane for us here, is the waste conversion and recovery technical division. So we will work on, and we hope that next year at SOAR, we will be able to bring forward presentations around the idea of processes, research specific to waste recovery facilities, waste energy facilities, and waste conversion facilities in North America. So we're really looking forward to having a robust discussion. I think I've had some conversations with folks, and instead of an academic paper, we're looking for presentations. We're looking for the opportunity to bring forward new ideas and share that with a larger audience at the SOAR conference. This here is what you'll see on our website in SWANA. It's sort of covers how that organization looks and the different committees that are underneath there. So all of the technical divisions are organized pretty much along the same. There's SWANA technical policies that you can research and go back and look. And some of these are pretty outdated. So we work as a committee to work on updating those policies and sort of bring them into the 2022 instead of maybe 1992. So let's talk about some of the real exciting opportunities I think that we have here. And that's around this job opportunity and business demand. I think you've all seen this sort of circular economy sort of diagram. I'm not going to walk through all that piece of it. But when you think about how far we've come as an industry and where we were in a comparatively short period of time, for me, it's pretty mind-boggling. I've had the opportunity to be there and sort of be at ground zero and see that. I spent about half my career with WM in a variety of different operational experiences, and about half my time in the public sector, most of it operating the facility that I ran in Monterey. And I think for many of the folks in the room, you've been able to see this as you've gone through in your business, in your expertise, how dramatic an impact for creations. Back in the early days, and I don't mean to go back all the way back in time, there weren't even recycling trucks invented. The early folks that were in this in the early 80s, they had to make their own equipment. They had to make their own recycling equipment, literally in the back of their shop. We've now seen a whole industry devote ourselves. How many people in this room right now have ideas, technologies that weren't even on the drawing boards as little as 5 years ago? This is where it's a huge opportunity for us. Huge opportunity to present ourselves as having solutions to part of the issues around climate change. And I think the emphasis on organics management that you'll hear more of during this conference here is another wonderful opportunity for us to take those organics and to be able to convert them and have a beneficial use from them, either from energy, right, conversion into energy, or into compost to make that happen. So I think you at the conference here are going to see and adapt to these technologies as they go forward. We can't really develop ourselves as an industry, however, if we don't choose to focus on a couple of sort of fundamental principles there. And as I think about it, I passed over when we were talking about safety, and if, forgive me for going into one story about how critical it is for us to be focused on safety. When I worked for WM, they had never had a large conference together where they brought all the managers in the country together. And they did that early, you know, in the early 2000s. And one of their initiatives was around safety. And the safety initiative was called Mission to Zero. So zero accidents and zero incidents. Well, I had run a hauling company by that time for, you know, almost 10 years. And all know, I had 150 routes out there. You're never going to have zero accidents. Well, that's just silly, I thought. What do you mean, zero accidents? That's just not possible. Forget that. So the VP of safety came out, and there was about 1,200 of us or so, 1,500, Mandalay Bay, came out, gave a big rah-rah speech about safety. As we filed in, a number of people were given a piece of paper. I didn't get one, but there were a number of people that did. And he was talking about the need to focus on, you know, zero as the only acceptable goal. And those of us that had been in the industry said, yeah, that's never going to happen. And then, in an instant, I got religion, because he asked everybody in the room that had that piece of paper to stand up. And people stood up, probably close to 10% of the crowd, enough so it was noticeable. And then he said something that was chilling to me and got me religion right away. He said, that's how many people we killed last year in our collection processes. And it's like, wow, that brought it to home. Those are real people standing there. So the message on safety, I think, aligns with our message on our pathway to, you know, where we can go in bettering ourselves. So to bring it back, one of the things that I think that we want to focus on and not forget about is, as we build our base of our industry, how do we bring young professionals in, and how do we include diversity, equity, and inclusion into our practices? So you can see, you know, most of the people here in this picture here, again, they'll probably fit under the under 40 range. This is the brain talent that we have to attract into our industry to make our industry continue to grow and develop, and make them know that this is a career of choice, which has been, I think, for many of us in this room, very exciting path for us to be. I know it has been for me. Along with that, SWANA has developed what's called a Young Professionals Leadership Academy. It's a year-long program designed to provide a little bit more extension than the mentorship program that we have, and give young professionals the opportunity to work side by side some of their more, I would say, experienced or seasoned colleagues in the industry, and be a guideway for them. This didn't really exist when I started out. I started out in a public works department, and the mentorship I got was, I'm the newest guy, so I bring the donuts. So, you know, that was the mentorship back then. And along with the young professionals is to work on our diversity, equity, and inclusion. I'm the vice chair of SWANA's task force on this, as we work to make our senior management look more aligned with our entry-level folks, and along with the mid-level supervisory folks as well, to make sure that we're creating those opportunities for growth in the area of equity and inclusion. So to sum up here, as we go forward for next year, those of you, who remembers Casablanca? Anybody? You know, oh, we don't have any movie buffs here. So at the end of the movie, you know, this is where Humphrey Bogart turns into Louis. I think this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship. And I think that our opportunity next year in April of 2003 in Atlanta with SOAR is, again, an opportunity for this beautiful friendship to develop between the Waste Conversion Technology Conference, you know, and SOAR, and to see you in Atlanta in April of 2023. And I just want to finish with saying, I want to thank the women and men in this industry for their dedication and their efforts and their success in moving this industry forward. I hope, and you know, I guess I'm California, so fifth generation, so I can be a little new agey. I hope that every one of you appreciates and affirms yourself for the huge contribution you make to the planet, to your community, to yourself. You know, take the time to really take the opportunity to pat yourself on the back. We're in an exciting, dynamic industry. You're doing important work for the benefit of the planet. And I'm happy to be here, and I hope you have a wonderful conference. Thank you for the invitation for me to be here. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Oh, got off easy. All right, I'll be here in and out. Thank you again for your attention. Thanks for showing up.
Thank you, Tim. I think what Tim was saying is all very important for us in the industry. And also going forward, and it's also important to think just going forward, not moving on, moving forward with the SWANA and how we're going to bring it together and moving it together, as Tim was saying. So that's very positive. So now I'd like to invite Mr. Richard Olliver, Chairman and CEO of Aplethora Vectors, to come up and speak about a snapshot of diverse waste energy projects in commercial development in the USA. Richard, thank you.
Thank you, Glenn. Appreciate it. Good morning, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here and look forward to a wonderful conference. I'm here with my company, Aplethora Vectors, and my partner for this industry, Scott Vanderau of Energy Transaction Advisors. We have a booth, and we hope that you'll come visit us during the course of the today and tomorrow. In essence, I'm a consultant, and as you may know, consultants are always looking to expand their connections and increase our gigs. And as such, I purchased a book recently called How to Make People Like You. Unfortunately, it was about cloning. Thank you. You can see the title of my paper, and my attempt here is to really provide a very simplistic overview of the ongoing activity in this industry, which is, I think, reflective of, very simply, a lot is going on in this country, and certainly, I think, even more so around the world. My initiative for creating this paper was involved in a significant due diligence effort about 6-7 months ago. And when I do due diligence, I like to do deep dive and develop some broader parameters for the specific project, and inclusive of that, to develop some benchmarks that are relative to a particular project or a particular technology. And in doing so, I found it to be very, very difficult using public information. I had to approach it on the internet, and many of the companies, their website names were different than their companies, and it presented a problem. There was limited information on many of these, so I had to really put quite an effort in order to come up with the type of information I was looking for. And as a result of that, I decided to put together a program that would look at the ongoing potential of projects ongoing in this industry, inclusive of that, the diversity of the technologies, the feedstocks, the products that are generated, and the various physical locations of those projects. As part of that, I drew rather arbitrarily to pick 8 projects from my proprietary database of over 150 technologies that are in this sector around the world. So the key point here is this is a very limited, narrow look at what's going on, and the broader array is very much active as well. The projects I'm listing are in various stages of project development, some early, some late, some have already started up, and I've tried to keep that information accurate as of about 30 days ago. This presentation is geared mainly looking at gasification and pyrolysis technologies, which limits it somewhat. As such, it ignores projects that are involved with landfill conversion, anaerobic digestion, mass burning, and other projects that essentially serve the same type of business. And the above all, the technology that is being talked about is not intended to be promotional. Rather, our whole position is technology neutral, such that we can look at and evaluate with full objectivity any opportunity that we're asked to pursue. And additionally, this presentation should not be used for investment purposes. I should note that by chance, several of the projects that I will be addressing are already as well being represented by some of the people in this room independently, and you'll be hearing more an in-depth presentation from each of those people regarding their particular technology and projects. I thought to start out, it would be good to take a look at the world and what's happening with regard to this industry. The Energy Information Administration in the U.S. about a year ago published this chart. It's very revealing. It shows the percent of total municipal solid waste that is burned with energy recovery in selected countries. Notably, Japan clearly is the world leader in addressing its waste problem, and at this point, roughly 75% of its available waste is processed into usable energy in some shape or form. Next, you see an array of European countries, and then also South Korea, and ultimately, at the low end of the chart there is the USA. I think that is reflective of the current state of where we are in relative terms. I think the key takeaway there is there's a tremendous potential here in the United States to utilize the services and activities of the people in this room and beyond to stimulate and grow the industry and create a new paradigm for waste conversion in the USA. Notably missing from this chart, and I don't know why, are other big places like China, India, Central America, South America, and Australia. They must have some activity going on, but there's no indication of what that is in this chart. Okay, this cuts to the quick. This is my Excel spreadsheet, a presentation of eight separate technologies that are ongoing in development in the USA. I should point out that the format and the size of it restricted me to just showing the columns that are there. Actually, the total spreadsheet has approximately 8 to 10 additional columns that gets into more detail of key contacts, phone numbers, websites, email addresses, and other commentary related to that particular technology. If any of you are interested, send me an email and I'll be happy to send you the total Excel spreadsheet for the projects that are shown here. The I think is indicative, if you can read that, there are essentially eight different technologies represented, eight different developers or technologies, of wide variety of feedstocks, waste feedstocks of all shapes and forms, and a variety of products that are generated by those particular projects. Moving ahead into a more detailed look at each of these, the first is Ares Clean Technologies. They're headquartered in Lebanon, Tennessee. They have many projects underway, and their inherent value proposition, they have two separate gasification technologies that are associated with different applications, different feedstocks, different type of products, and they market those and are doing quite well based on the number of projects they allude to in their on their website. This particular project is based in Linden, New Jersey, and it takes biosolids from a waste treatment plant that's been operating for many years, and according to public information, they should be up and operating with this project even as we speak. A further description of some of the other activity they have going on. You can just see from the photos and the descriptions that there are quite a few different sites. They don't really reveal the products of these, but certainly the feedstocks vary, and I think it's reflective of the strength and diversity of their gasification technologies that they utilize. Next company is Frontline Bioenergy. They're headquartered in, of all places, Nevada, Iowa. Their project in California, and specifically in McFarland, California, takes organic waste, that is branches and other dead material from an orchard, and converts it to essentially a synthetic natural gas, which they call CNG. And when they finish, they're able to inject that into a natural gas pipeline. It's referred to as the San Joaquin Renewables Project, and it suggests that they have getting some type of financial and commercial support by being a renewable. Frontline is unique in the sense that it offers a very, very diverse portfolio of all of the process steps involved in going from feedstock to products. They have a component that is essentially addressing feed preparation, which they're prepared to design and install. They have gasification elements, which are commercially proven. They have their own gas cleanup processes. And finally, they have a variety of product or gas, syngas upgrade processes, which are designed to produce specific higher value products. Fulcrum Bioenergy just announced, as reflected on this slide, as recently as this past May, that they've successfully started up operations of its Sierra Biofuels plant in, well, near Reno, Nevada. And that is a full-scale MSW to gasification and other technologies that is designed to produce Fischer-Tropsch liquid fuels. It's the world's first waste-to-fuels plant, which a major milestone, including the production of syngas from landfill waste. It uses the TRI gasification technology, which is also commercially proven. Here's a snapshot of that site, and you can see it's a fairly extensive facility in terms of its size and so forth. And they right now are in the final stages of commissioning and startup of the entire facility, including the ultimate end products. Green Waste Energy, who you'll be hearing from a little bit later in the program, is headquartered in Greenwich, Connecticut. I hope that's right. That's my understanding. And they have a project, one of several in development. One is in Schenectady, New York. And they essentially have reliance on their technology portfolio, which they call C6. And then as such, they can create various process scenarios and configurations in order to handle different feedstocks and develop production of various higher upgraded products. There's the, here's the block flow of one of those scenarios, and their representative will certainly be telling you a lot more about the specifics of their process and their development activity. H Cycle is a relatively new company. I think they've been in business for only about 6 months now. They're headquartered in Los Angeles, and they're a relatively new player in the waste energy conversion arena. Their primary focus, as noted, is they produce hydrogen, and they're representing that they will be the low-cost provider of hydrogen, taking waste as a feedstock and converting it to hydrogen using commercially proven technologies. And they're developing several projects in Southern California, which no specifics are yet available. The technology they're using is called Omni Conversion, and again, it's been proven in various locations, and they're going to be they appear to be very, very aggressive in terms of their marketing, what they're trying to do in the hydrogen market. Another California project is being developed by SG H2 Energy, headquartered in Washington, D.C. They use, in essence, a plasma arc technology, which some of you may be familiar with, and it's very unique in its attributes. Has very high temperatures, and as such is capable of destroying just about everything in utilizing that process. They've announced a project which they say the world's largest green hydrogen plant in Lancaster, California. By pure circumstance, I drove through Lancaster earlier in the week, and it's a community out in Southern California, and looking forward to the progress of that particular project. This is, again, it utilizes plasma arc, and that's a photo that they have on their website showing, in essence, the one of the burners of the creating the plasma arc flame. The technology specifically that they use is Solena SPEG technology. Sierra Energy, who will also be speaking a little bit later in the program, so I won't say much, but I'm sure they'll elaborate on the specifics of where they are and what their status of their technology. They're headquartered in Davis, California. Their process is called the Fast Ox process, and as you note, Golf, the Daily Digest, announced that their particular technology and project is among the top 50 hottest project in the bioeconomy in 2022. Their site that they've announced is at Fort Hunter Liggett military installation in Southern California. Uses simple block flow. The simple message here is they can handle a variety of waste feedstocks and produce a variety of products. And finally, we have West Biofuels, headquartered in Woodland, California. The project they have developed is Hat Creek Bioenergy, which is the first forest wood waste to power, and is representative of utilizing their particular gasification technology, which can serve and handle a variety of feedstocks. And that plant is located in Burney, California. It's essentially a fluidized bed gasification process. And again, the syngas produced from that technology in these projects can be used for various products. A little advertisement, again, as we're concluding here, a plethora of vectors and energy transaction advisors are partnered in a consulting mode to serve specifically the waste-to-energy industry. We've recently worked together on several due diligence assignments, which were pretty high-powered and not only interesting from an intellectual perspective, but a lot of fun to work with something that was real and needed a thorough and an accurate evaluation in order for investors to consider writing checks. The Aplethora Vectors and ETA are working together to provide technical and commercial advisory services to the waste conversion industry. And without dwelling on it, you can see the variety of services that we provide. The key takeaway is due diligence is what we do, and we do it very, very well. At this point, I'd like to thank you all for listening to my story. For further information, you can contact myself or Scott Vanderau. Please visit our booth. We'll be happy to get to know you and vice versa. And with that, happy to take questions. Yes, sir. There we go.
Thank you for the presentation. Could you please tell me a little more about the storage of CO2 or sequestration of CO2? Like, is there any existing company who is working with that? In your last slide, can you go back to your last slide?
Yes.
So the storage or a CO2 sequestration?
Yes. The team of people that we assemble from both companies has really long-standing, I mean, going back 15, 20 years, primarily in the gasification and pyrolysis arena, and also oil and gas projects where in recent years people are looking at CO2 sequestration, carbon sequestration. We have a significant group of chemical engineers that have hands-on experience with it, done a number of projects. And so I'd say we have good expertise in that particular aspect. Frankly, recently we looked at technologies that take waste material and convert a gas product that is hydrogen and physical carbon, and there is no CO2. It's CO2 pure. It's gone. And we're looking in more depth at that particular configuration because it's intriguing because of the very, very reasons that you're suggesting.
Thank you.
Thanks. Just to address that question, actually, I think San Joaquin Renewables has applied for CO2 sequestration for their project.
I believe that's correct, yes.
Yeah. So there is one of those companies on there that is focusing on that, and it's gone through the permitting and getting underway.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. I was just curious if there's kind of like a typical size for capacity, like a ton per day that most of these facilities have, and are most of them already operating at a close to full capacity, or do they still look for more feedstock?
I may be off here, but my sense of it is that most of the full MSW spectrum feedstocks are in a couple thousand tons a day, somewhere between 2,000 and 4,000 tons a day. And then there's an issue, is that a dry measure or is that just unloaded with moisture? But that's generally the size of the larger MSW projects. The other feedstocks, I think, are you're getting down on probably under 1,000 tons a day and measured in several hundred tons a day of feedstock. Again, in this case, probably on a dry basis. I think the opportunity for the industry is most of the technologies that I show have a tremendous opportunity to scale up from which at the moment is relatively small. And I think there's a tremendous opportunity to that. What's that's going to take is commercial size units appearing at any size and showing to the bankers and the financiers that the system works as advertised, and so they can move to the next level. And it's a tremendous opportunity for the people in this room, frankly. Okay, thank you very much.
Glen, before you introduce Tim, we've got some folks standing in the back of the room. If you all want to come up, I know we've got a couple of seats up front, so if you want to sit down, you're welcome to. I've never had a conference where my exhibit hall is completely empty and everybody's in the room. I don't know how to set up for this. This is great.
Thank you very much, Tim. Thanks, Gene. I think you will see what Richard was saying. Sorry, not Tim, Richard was saying, it's very important to see there's a lot of technologies out there. Some are working very well, some are new, some are making the headways out there in different sizes, some are being commissioned right as we speak. So there's a lot of impetus, a lot of stuff going on out there with things that are working and are becoming mature, and it'd be very interesting to bring a lot of these, I think we're saying, to the SOAR. Next year, and I'm sure you'll be seeing some of them there. Before I introduce the next speaker, Timothy Kelley, I just noticed today and also yesterday, this is a conference of Tims. We got Tim Flanagan, Timothy Kelley, and one that was, you got another Tim back there, and one that was misspelled, but he corrected it, was Timo from Germany. So it's a conference of Tims. Yeah. Let's do this. All right. Timothy Kelley, President and CEO of Imperial Valley Economic Development Corporation, developing e-waste conversion cluster. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. You know, I never met a Tim I didn't like, so let's not change that, Mr. Flanagan. So, you know, I got this email just a second ago from Gene. Tim, your PowerPoint's not working. So that's the last thing you want to hear when you're getting ready to give a presentation. So we'll get through this. I wanted to start off by saying I'm from the Imperial County, and my presentation is not about Imperial County. It's really about developing a cluster, but I'm going to use a lot of examples of what we've done to develop that cluster. And I think that Sean, and I want to recognize Sean Wilcock, he's our Vice President of Business Development. Over the years, I think we saw this industry, you know, almost 15 years ago taking off, and it hasn't taken off as fast as we were hoping, but we're in a very, very good position, I think, us and others, to be able to take advantage and help companies, not only here in California, but throughout the globe. Do we have anybody here from Southern California Gas Company or San Diego Gas and Electric? Good. I'll be talking about natural gas a little bit. LA Sanitation, how about LA Sanitation? All right, so if I get anything wrong, then they won't know. So I just want to start off by saying that I happen to be the president of an organization called Team California, and we have our CEO in the back, and her name is Robin Reinfeld, and she's done a great job. What Team California is an organization that does the external marketing for the state of California. We have about 100 members, and we have a couple here, Jenny. We had a board meeting yesterday, and one of the things we talked about was our plans for next year, but in that we talk about trade shows, conferences that we want to attend, and we also prioritize those, and one of the things we've prioritized is going to be waste conversion. And we see that this is a market. As mentioned earlier, California, who here is from California? Okay, so those that are not from California look at California from the outside and think we're crazy. And we're in California saying, you know, we kind of know we're different, but You know, the one thing that's interesting, though, is a lot of the legislation that's been passed in California, regulations that we think are difficult, surprisingly has created an interest globally about where you want to do projects. And so it's kind of like, if you can do it in California, you can do it anywhere. And California has also put a lot of legislation in place. I think that virus has spread to other states, especially Oregon, Washington, and then came down the East Coast, and now it's starting to converge in the center part of the U.S. And so we know that we're the leaders in a lot of legislation that has led to a lot of regulation, which sometimes we don't like, but it's also created that interest and has driven a market. So we just got to take it for what it is. But what we're doing in Team California is we're actually marketing the state. And what do you think we hear when we go to other states? You guys are crazy. You can't get a project done. And my response is, well, it's not for the weak. It's got to be for, you know, companies that are strong. You know, we're not giving handouts to corporations, but we want to make sure we incentivize them, that they're successful. We practice a policy which is called the triple bottom line. How many of you have heard of the triple bottom line? Good. Two. Wow. Three. Let's talk about that for a second, because what we're doing here today is we're talking about technologies and other things that are really going to be changing the industry, good for the environment, good for the people. And guess what? Triple bottom line is people, planet, and prosperity. So so if you think about that, it's like we want projects that are going to be good for the people. They're going to be good for the environment, and of course they have to be profitable. And so if you put those three P's together, you're going to create what is called sustainability. And I think what's really important is what I do is, I mentioned we do marketing and we attract businesses, but then we go through this whole process of trying to get these projects completed. And along that, you've got to get the community to support that project. And not all projects are deemed to be good for the community. And so we have to make sure that we can work with people. Now, what the direction we're moving right now, we want to bring down greenhouse gas emissions. How are we going to do that? Well, we're going to have solar power. We're going to have wind turbines. We're going to have electric vehicles. Okay. You know how difficult it is to build a solar park? You know, you'd think that people would be in favor of it. Or build a wind turbine. You think people would be in favor of it, but you could imagine how people line up opposing projects. And that's what I spend a lot of time doing, is I don't support the projects. What I do is I come in with the data. I first of all try to dispute a lot of the information that's incorrect. And I did learn one word you don't use is I'll come back to that later. But is making sure you have the facts. How is this project going to be good for the community? How many jobs is it going to be create? What are the taxes that are going to be generated? And how is it going to benefit the environment? And so if you put all those things together, then people really can't dispute that. And what we find is that one side or the other, those are in favor, that are opposed, they look at the numbers and they go, well, you can't dispute that, so let's move forward. And remember, it's elected officials that have to, or appointed officials and planning commissions that have to move these projects forward. And so what we've done is tried to develop a situation, and for my organization, our vision is to grow the economy, diversify the economy. We're a highly agriculture area. We have over 500,000 acres of agriculture land. We provide about 95% of the lettuce in the wintertime for the entire United States, if you can imagine that, between Imperial County and Yuma, broccoli, spinach, and other things. So when everything else is under snow, we're actually planting and harvesting crops throughout the wintertime. So it's a very unique situation. We're a desert, and we happen to have the most water in the southwestern United States. And I think that's the first thing when people think about where I live, they go, you're in a desert, you have no water. And we go, no, actually we have the most water. It's not that we don't have any, we actually have the most. And put in perspective, we have about 5.3 acre feet of water per acre. So you know how much that is? 5.3 feet. So if you can imagine if it rained 5.3 feet, that's how much water we have that we use for agriculture. But that also means we have water for other uses such as industry. And I don't know if a couple of years ago, if you remember, that the governor of California came out and said, California's in a drought. And you should have heard the crickets in California of businesses that are looking at California. Well, if you don't have water, then you can't have projects, correct? One thing you didn't say is California's in a drought except for the Imperial County. because we don't get our water from California. We get our water from the Colorado River. As a matter of fact, it's 1/5. So you got to think about those unique differences. And I think for Team California, the marketing that we do as we're marketing throughout the country and other places is making sure you look at a state like California in the whole, that it's not just Los Angeles, it's not just San Francisco. There's areas that are want development, areas that are affordable, areas that have water, areas that have energy, areas that really a desire to grow and prosper, and they want you. And I think the opposite is what people think about California. So when you think about where projects are going to be, and that's really what my presentation is about, because we've got technologies here. But where are those technologies going to be built? Where can they be built? And where do people want them? And so what we've done is put together a program in our region, Sean and I, and what we want to do is really take this program on the road and see how we can do projects, how can we get them done. Just put in perspective, what projects have we done over the last 10 years is about $10 billion of investment. And our population is about 190,000. $10 billion is a lot of money. I don't know any place in the state that's done that much. Right now we have about $20 billion of projects that are at the end of the being permitted and being ready to be built, and we have about another $20 billion that are on the way. And so we're really excited about the times, but a lot of those, even though, and I just want to throw something out there, the Lithium Valley, you could look it up, there's a lot of interest in the lithium industry. We just happen to have an anomaly that is probably the largest amount of lithium in North America is under our feet, and we're in the process of liquid mining that lithium, purifying it, converting it, and then bringing in manufacturers. And so one of the companies, we have Berkshire Hathaway, which has large investments, they're building a project right now, as well as energy source, and then a new company from Australia called CTR, who actually came to build a geothermal plant. No one wanted to buy the power, so now they're taking the brine and going to be converting into lithium. And so our next goal is to attract a battery manufacturer. So it's the supply chain. And so we just announced a couple weeks ago a $4 billion investment for a company called StateVolt, which is going to be operating in our county. What does this have to do with recycling? Well, about 10% of all batteries manufactured need to be recycled. So I believe in the state of California, if there's going to be a recycling plant built here, they have to have a way that they're going to be able to recycle batteries. Otherwise, 10% of all the batteries are going to be piling up, and they're going to be sitting there. Or we're going to be taking them to other states, and we're going to be recycling them there. So I don't know how we got here. But so what are some of the assets that we do have? And you know, the process, and you've probably heard about how difficult it is to get projects. Sean and I, when we go to trade shows, we walk around with the projects that we've done, because the number one thing we hear is that you can't get a project done in California. It's like, well, yeah, we can. And this is an example. We've been able to get these projects done. But the number one thing is has to do with the CEQA process. Are you familiar with the CEQA process? Okay, you don't want to know about the CEQA process. Okay. The objective is to avoid CEQA. And what CEQA is, the California Environmental Act, and it was put in place really to put the environmentalist and industry on an even playing field. It's like, okay, let's you bring a project forward, this process starts, and then everybody's got opportunity to give their input, and then you get the project done. But really what it does is it triggers a minimum time frame for a project to be reviewed. And it's about 180 days, okay? 180 days is what it takes to get through this process, if it's all done right. The challenge is that it creates an opportunity where if somebody doesn't like the project, they file a lawsuit, and then you kind of start that time over again. So you've probably heard of projects that takes 10 years or 20 years to get done. That's why. So our goal is to, how do we get to that minimum amount of time, which is 120 days. And that can be done. And so rather than talk about the CEQA, it's better to talk about examples. And Sean and I worked on a project that's about a $92 million project, about 700,000 square feet. It was financed, and we're going to start paying interest in 365 days. So we had to get that thing built, and we just had to start generating income. And we went to our county planning department, our utilities and others, and we said, here's the project. It's going to create these 300 jobs. It's going to bring taxes to the community. Do you want it? They said, yeah, we want it. And I go, how long is it going to take? And they said 3 to 4 years. And I go, 3 to 4 years? I got to get this thing done in a year. Design build. And so we started this process working with the county, and guess what? 367 days later, it was finished. And when it was finished, everybody said, we can't believe we did that. And no one could believe we did it. But it was a process that we went through working with everybody and figuring out what the challenges were on trying to develop a project and see if we get that minimum of CEQA. The key to this is industrial parks. And this is not my final presentation. I told you I had a little problem, but I just wanted to mention a couple of them. So going to an area that's already zoning, and really what the challenge is in California is rezoning property. That's what triggers the CEQA process. But if the property is already zoned, then basically it's allowable use. You can just move forward very quickly. And so these are just a couple of the projects we have. In the Mesquite Lake Industrial Park is 5,100 acres, and that's specifically planned. And then we have about another 3,000 acres that are generally planned. And the difference is we can probably pull a permit in the specifically planned area in about 6 weeks. In the general plan, it might take a year. If it's not general plan, it might take you 5 years. That's the difference. And so what we do is we direct people into the right locations. And this industrial park, the Mesquite Lake, which has changed its name to the Keystone Planning Area, named by a planner, not great for marketing. But the key to that is that we can bring projects in there at their allowable use, and we can build them very quickly. And so, as I mentioned, one project we did took us 6 weeks to do a non-declaration and start construction. And actually, we didn't have a permit for trenching. And they said, go ahead and start, but if it's done wrong, you got to start over again. And so we took that risk. Gateway of the Americas is a 1,700 acre specifically planned area. It's probably about 500 acres of that is being occupied. And then we have two new industrial parks we're working on. One for this Lithium Valley, which is 9,000 acres, John? About 9,000 acres. So it's a lot of acres. And so we have the geothermal plants. We'll have the extraction and the facilities. We'll have the wells, injection, and production wells. And so that process can move very quickly. And then what we're doing is we're zoning it for being able to take e-waste from this industry and actually recycle it at that location, whether it's being made there or being brought in by other areas. And then the other one just adjacent to that is we call the Inland Port. It's going to be strictly a rail to everything coming in will be by rail. It's about 5,000 acres. And that's probably about two and a half years away. So we do all the work up front, and we make it easy for companies to be able to come in. And so our big job is this is where you should go, not where you want to go, and we'll make your life easy. If you don't, it's going to be another situation. And so what we do is we've been talking around the state and trying to get other communities to understand this and make sure they're looking at those industry clusters. There is an organization that I sit on called the Overall Economic Development Commission, and we do what's called the SED study, Comprehensive Economic Development Strategic Plan. Why does that matter? Well, if you're applying for workforce dollars or if you're applying for EDA dollars, Economic Development Administrations, any projects you have in there, any project you want to get be funded has to be in that plan. And it's redone every year, it's updated every year, put in every 5 years. So how many of you ever heard of that, the SEDS document? Okay, two of you. Any place you go in the United States, they have to have that document. And so one thing you need to make sure is this industry cluster is in that document. Because if it's not in that document, you can't apply for the funds until you actually put it in. And then there's a lot of organizations such as workforce training, federal workforce dollars, will follow that plan. And so if you want to hire people and have subsidized employees and training, it's got to be in that plan also. So that's called the SEDS document. Make sure that your communities are aware of that. And so we made sure that industry cluster was in our SEDS document. So now we can go to the EDA or USDA and others, and we already have a plan that says this is where we want to be when we grow up. We just need help with funding, and they can fund us. And I mentioned USDA because everybody knows what USDA is, United States Department of Agriculture. Okay, how many of you are in rural communities? How many of you want to do projects in rural communities? I hope so, because that's where you get projects done. The key to the USDA is like this SBA of rural communities. So if you're in a rural community, you can have projects funded through the SBA, Small Business Administration, or USDA Rural Development. And so we work with them quite a bit, but most people aren't even aware of that. Who would think that you're building a recycling project and you'd go to the USDA to do that? And so keep that in mind. That's one of the things that, we have in place. So in the industrial parks, they have an environmental impact report. So that's already been done ahead of time. The zoning's already in place. Now you want to do a project, and then our planning director would meet with you and talk about, okay, what's the project going to do? What are the emissions going to be? And if you can determine what the emissions are going to be, then we work with our air pollution control district. So are you familiar with air pollution control districts? Okay, do you like them? So I was meeting with a site selector, and I said, what's the toughest thing about doing business in California? You know what she told me? The air pollution control district. And I said, which one? And she goes, isn't there only one? And I go, no, there's dozens. And so you got to think about, you know, that locations have different air pollution control districts. And our county just our entire county is one district. And so it's very easy for us to maneuver. And some of the other districts, you can kind of look throughout the state and say, what is the waiting list to get a project through? And some, it could be a year, it could be 2 years. For us, it's about 3 days. And so that's the difference, and to be very aware of that. And so we work very close with our air pollution control district to determine what the emissions are going to be and get these projects done. So I did mention the Lithium Valley. I did mention the Inland Port. The Inland Port is going to be a logistics center from rail from the Port of Los Angeles. And then product would be brought in, and then it would be taken out by truck or by rail. And so very important. With the solar industry, we've developed a overlay for renewable energy projects. And so we similar to an industrial park, we did an overlay. And we'd done that many years ago for the geothermal industry. We developed 9 KGRAs, or known geothermal resource areas, that you basically, similar to a specific planned area, you can just go there and pull the permits and start building. It's not that simple, but it's going to reduce the time quite a bit. And just a quick story, there was a guy that worked for a geothermal company, and all he did was complain how tough things were, how difficult it was, and for years. And then he moved away and went to another region, and I saw him at a trade show, and I said, how are things going up in Kern County? He goes, God, I wish I was back in Imperial County. And nothing against Kern, he just didn't realize, you know, that things are difficult, but they could be a lot worse. And so, you know, what we do is try to make them easy. We don't make them easy, we just make them less hard. So one of the programs that we have, and let me just go through this. Some of the assets that you need to think about is when you're doing a project is, of course, you know, access to rail, highways, natural gas pipelines. Why are natural gas pipelines important? Well, it's either you need natural gas to run your plant, or you're producing a product that can go into natural gas. And the reason I mentioned Southern California Gas Company or San Diego Gas and Electric is making a huge effort. So if you think about the gas company, what do? They sell gas. How do they sell it? They bring it in pipes. So they've got this freeway of these pipelines. And if we're trying to decarbonize our economy, then those pipelines or that freeway is going to be utilized in the future for other products such as hydrogen. So if you think about it, that infrastructure is already in place. Thousands and thousands of miles throughout Southern California, even throughout the United States, which, by the way, can take other types of fuels. And so I think that's very important is location, and that how we have infrastructure already in place that you can move product from one place to the other. So when you think about where the market is and where the product's going to be used, it may not be produced in that location. So we're taking possibly a waste stream to another location, we're producing an energy, how do we get it back? It's either going by rail, or it's going to be by truck, or it's going to be by pipe. And fortunately, the infrastructure's in place to do that. I mentioned the CEQA, and one of the things that really helps you overcome the CEQA process is the zoning of the property. And so as I mentioned, throughout California, if it's zoned correctly, it's going to be a lot easier than if it's not. Legislation, there's quite a bit of legislation that's in place in California for waste conversion. And to be honest with you, I think the municipalities are really trying to figure out what they're going to do with green waste. They're not building facilities fast enough. And so the opportunity is there. We're trying to make sure that we're prepared by having the locations ready to go, the infrastructure in place, invite the people to come in, and now you got to find the feedstock. And I think that's what Gene's good at. And so one of the programs that we have is the RMDZ. Are you familiar with an RMDZ? Okay, if you're in the recycling business, you've got to know about the RMDZ. This is one of the greatest incentives in California in this industry. Recycling Marketing Development Zone. And so it's about 38 in the state of California. I think it's 88,000 square miles. And so there's things that happen in an RMDZ. First of all, it's called marketing because what you do is you set up a company within one of these zones, and then basically you need feedstock. And so it triggers somebody that has feedstock, somebody that needs feedstock, and allows for the facilitation of getting that feedstock to a facility. And then, I just looked it up this morning, there's a $37 million that's available right now for companies that are either trying to become, use better recycled materials or improve their equipment, et cetera. And with this program, the interest rate right now is 4%. Now let's say they run out of money. It's a conduit for other programs. And so if you need money for a project, whether it's construction, real estate, improving your equipment, et cetera, then you contact your RMDZ, and then they say, we're out of money this year. But we got another department that has money. Kelley, PA is an example. And it becomes a conduit for people to take that money from one department through the RMDZ to fund projects. So that's one way to fund projects. I mentioned USDA rural development. Now I've mentioned the RMDZ. And then I just want to bring up again with the Air Pollution Control District, if we're taking product off the road and reducing emissions, then there are programs that are available. So that's the other thing, is that there's no such thing as a clean project. You're going to create emissions. It could be truck traffic, it could be car traffic, people just driving back and forth to work. So they determine how many tons of CO2 are going to be emitted and how much dust you're going to create. And so the thing is, those things can be mitigated. So how do you mitigate dust? You put asphalt down or base on a road. You plant a park. And that's going, you put in a park for the community. And so that's called mitigation. And those things that just expected, it's throughout the state, in many cases throughout the United States. So these are the top industry clusters that we work on in our region. And many of these are throughout the state of California. But the thing about these industry clusters, and I mentioned these are all in our SEDS document, but the one that we're seeing the most activity on right now is logistics. And lithium industry and the batteries, et cetera, and recycled materials, okay, conversion. And so those are the three that we're seeing the most. We really see the increase of what's occurring in our region. And so these are the top recycling markets that we're working with. We've got three hydrogen plants that we're working on in our county. I think one's getting near to purchasing their land, going into escrow, right, Sean? Okay, so under contract right now. And so the difference is, blue and green hydrogen, I don't know if I need to tell you the difference. Green hydrogen is basically 100% renewable. Blue could be from other sources, maybe 50%. I think there's a ratio that's considered blue hydrogen. What does it matter if we have hydrogen cars if we're producing it with coal fire plants, right? And so that's the difference of the two. There's a market for green hydrogen. And so companies that want to purchase hydrogen, the more green it is, the better. Solar panels. So think about this, California, I think about 2007, I put on a renewable energy conference and everybody thought I was crazy. They go, why would you put on a renewable energy conference? Renewable energy is too expensive. And I go, well, I think I see legislation coming in the future that's going to require that we move toward renewable energy. And so I put on this conference. It just turned out that we had the second most geothermal in the state of California, so we're already a leader there. We had no wind, we had no solar. And they said there'd never be solar in our Canada because our electricity rates are too low. 3 years later, we led the nation in solar energy, are now the number one county for export of renewable energy in North America. So that all started around 2008. 2010 is when they want, the companies need to be at 10%. And now we're moving toward 50%. Okay, so does anybody know how long solar panels are good for? 20 years. So think about that. 2020, what do you think is happening right now? We're taking those solar panels, we'll replace them either because we have new efficient ones or they're worn out. And where are we taking them? There's no place to recycle, unless you can tell me. There's no place to recycle these panels in California. So there's a huge opportunity there. And every year it's going to be panels that are coming out of production. And then with ethanol, another one, we have two ethanol plants we're working on. And it's kind of interesting, the synergies that go on between these companies. And so we're working on this ethanol plant. They're going to be producing power. Another company comes in, and guess what they need? They need the gas so they can convert into jet fuel. Okay. So do you know what that market is for jet fuel right now, green jet fuel, renewable jet fuel? As much as you can make, they have to buy. If it's available, they have to buy it. And right now, they're probably at 1%. And so that's a huge opportunity for us. So jet fuel and wind blades, okay? Wind power is pretty neat. I was involved in a project, Pattern Energy, I think it was about 240 megawatts, and it's been in production. But constantly, they're taking down blades, and what do you think they do with them? Well, in other areas, they're burying them, but that's going to stop. And so it's got to be reused, recycled. No place to do that. And so that's the next market we're looking at, products, basically cut them up and recycle them. And so there's technologies that are coming about to do that. I mentioned green waste, e-waste, batteries are going to be a big one. I think it's already an issue. It's going to become more of an issue, and so we need to have solutions for that. And that's almost it. I just wanted to go over a couple things really quick. And I did mention the triple bottom line is something we need to think about, is that you're in this business. First of all, you're in business, so you want to turn a profit. But I hope you're also in it because you think it's something that's needed, something that's good for the environment, and so do I. And the thing that I think about every day is, generating the taxes and creating the jobs for the people in my community. One other project I didn't mention, and I think we had her as a speaker here several years ago. With Oberon Fuels, which is dimethyl ether. Have you ever heard of dimethyl ether, DME? DME is almost a 100% efficient fuel in as far as emissions goes. And the first DME plant in North America is actually in our county. It's used a lot in Sweden and Norwegian states, I believe also in Germany, but also a little bit in China. And dimethyl ether, the problem, and this is I just want to mention one of the problems with a lot of these projects is they're so big. And how do you make a project more profitable? You make it bigger. And sometimes that runs into trouble because the bigger it gets, the more money that's going to be needed, but it becomes more profitable. So the challenge is, how do you downsize a project? How do you make a project that's suitable for a community and what the feedstock is and what the need is for that community? And so that's even a bigger challenge. I'm working on a project right now with San Diego State University and two universities in Florida and an Indian tribe and also at the community college on a virtual plant for water, basically be able to take water plants and reduce them down for communities like 3,300, which is challenging. Bigger is better, but if you only need 3,000 hookups, you don't need it that big. But then how do you pay for it, I think is the other problem. So anyway, what we've done, Sean and I have really developed a program to help projects move forward quick. We have to overcome that stigma of you can't get projects done. Yes, we can. And this is the way you do it. We've got the method to the madness. You've got to have the infrastructure in place. You've got to have the highways. You've got to have the rail. You've got to have the natural gas power lines. You've got to have the electricity. And then all of a sudden, you open the doors. And so that's what we're now is marketing these locations. And if we have the right pharma, we go throughout the state with the help of Team California, community, that need the programs. We're doing that same with the water treatment facilities, and then we take that across the nation. And actually, some of our partners and some of our grants are international, and they have a need as great or more than we have in North America. And so that's our goal, is to get to even the Caribbean islands and others. So thank you very much. I'll be here all week. Sean Wilcock is here if you need to speak with him. And is Robin still in the room? There's Robin with Team California. If there's a region throughout California you're looking at, then talk to Robin. We'll help you make that introduction to a community throughout California that we can work with. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Timothy. it has really changed my mind from saying crazy Californians, to, and it's not no longer that. To see what they're doing along this line and thinking about the environment, setting up these different projects, and reducing the times to get these projects to fruition, that's really great. I've heard, also heard that it takes 10 years in California to get anything done. Well, damn it, you've really shown us a little bit more. That's great. It's good news. A little sidetrack on the timing of things. I think Timo can say it too. In Germany, for example, if you have a special project on waste to energy or things like that, it is governed by the Bundesemissionsschutzgesetz, that is the federal emissions control law. And if you fill out their forms, and they're quite extensive, you want an engineering company to do that, and fill it out correctly, and you fill in all the blanks correctly, they have to approve it. There's no reason not to. You have to do also public hearings, local public hearings. That's a separate thing that's, let's say, not on the form. That has to be done too. But they're required to approve it. I think it's in 45 days or something like that. Depends on the thing. So if you get all your homework done in the beginning, they have to approve it in 45 days. And maybe something like that, one can hope that that can come from the Fed down here in the U.S. But maybe that's just a dream right now. I don't know. The next one, David Wilkinson, will he be doing it per video? Okay. So Jim, you take it on, and you gonna do the same stuff?
Yeah. Okay. Okay, no problem. Good morning, my name is Jim Phillips with True North Renewable Energy. And I appreciate the opportunity to speak to everyone this morning. I was referred by Imperial County, so I just want to give a plug for them. They've been great to work with. True North Renewable Energy, we're a development company. We're not a technology company, we're technology agnostic. So hopefully the information I'll provide today could be beneficial to other companies looking to develop waste conversion technologies anywhere in the country. What we're going to cover today is just an overview of what's happening in California with legislation. We'll talk a little bit about different technology solutions that have been developed by other companies to try to address some of these needs on the organic side of things. We'll talk about high solids, anaerobic digestion technology, the benefits, some technical information about the design of what a plant looks like. And then we'll talk about the market challenges. There's quite a few market challenges, whether it's here or other parts of the country. So we'll talk about legislation. So, my opinion, legislation, whether it's in Europe or here in the U.S., or especially here in California, legislation drives development of projects. It drives development of technologies, especially when it comes to waste conversion and turning waste into something that's valuable. So there has to be some driver behind that. There's always lower cost solutions to process material, whether that be landfilling the material or just other methods of processing that are less expensive. For example, in my industry, compost is less expensive than processing with anaerobic digestion. So that's what we're competing against. But in California, we have a law that was passed, SB 1383. It requires California to reduce methane emissions, greenhouse gas. It was mentioned earlier by Tim that this is really a greenhouse gas bill, not necessarily a waste bill, but the impacts of SB 1383 are impacting how we manage our organic waste stream. So really the goal of that is to reduce organics going to landfill by 75% by the year 2025. That's a huge reduction. And that's your driver. So, how do you get organics out of the landfill and then what do you do with it? So there's really two choices. You can compost it or you can process it with technology like anaerobic digestion. And we'll talk about some different anaerobic digestion technologies as well. So with this law, the idea is that we'd have expanded infrastructure to manage this. And, CalRecycle has put out a report, and CalRecycle says that we need 50 to 100 new facilities in California to manage this additional 20 to 25 million tons of organic waste. Now, I see someone laughing in the audience. I think you're laughing because that's probably, it's optimistic that we're getting, number one, going to get 20 to 25 million tons of organic waste. Number two, do we really need 50 to 100 new facilities? So, you know, we'll talk about that in the market challenges slide. I think that's overly optimistic. Usually state agencies are. That's how they keep their jobs. So. The other law that was passed is California SB 1440. It's a biomethane procurement program. This is extremely important for everyone in this room because this really is a driver for waste conversion technologies, whether it's biomass or whether it's organics. But really, there's a lot of things that are tied from our perspective on the organic side of things, on the green waste, because it's providing an incentive and really it's a mandate for, you know, companies like SoCalGas to procure a certain percentage of biomethane. And that helps really lift the value of RNG in the market, which is important for us to build a facility, or if you're going to build some type of waste facility that converts organics, you need that boost on the RNG side. So it calls for a 40% reduction in methane and other short-lived climate pollutants by 2030. We've been heavily involved on the legislative side, you know, putting in comments and supporting this, as well as other companies like Energia, who are developing AD facilities. So we're really all kind of working together to try to promote this bill. It's very important. So when you look at the procurement target, it's tremendous. I mean, it's 8 million tons of organic waste. There's not anywhere close to that. I mean, we're talking like a few hundred thousand tons a year right now of organic waste that are being processed that generate RNG. So there's a huge need for RNG that's derived from organics, which is great. That's a huge plus for what we're doing, but that doesn't necessarily solve the problem. So what type of waste? You know, we're looking at, from our perspective, we look at commingled organics, so residential organic waste, so that's your green waste, your food waste, commercial food waste, so anything related to the organic sector. You can use that material to generate, you know, renewable natural gas. And that's really what our facilities are designed for, and several other ones that we'll cover here in a second. So I thought I'd just give you an overview of what's happening in the market in general, not necessarily related to what True North does, but just what we're seeing in the California market. So for example, a company named Energia is really a leader in the low solids anaerobic digestion side. So they've done some really unique things with partnering with existing wastewater treatment plants. So they're actually a technology developer, and they're also a project developer like us, but what they've done is they've taken existing digestion capacity at a wastewater treatment plant, they've applied their technology to it, and now they can process low solids organic. So low solids is a slurry. Essentially, it's something that requires a lot of water. It's usually derived from commercial food waste. So you take commercial food waste, combine that with water, it goes through a press, and then it creates this slurry that you can process at a low solids AD facility. CRNR has a high solids AD facility in Paris, California. That's similar to technology to what we're developing. That high solids AD can process up to, you know, 70, 80, 90% green waste, 10% food waste. Their mix right now, coming off the streets, it's about 90% green and 10% food, or a little bit less than 10% food. The Rialto Bioenergy Facility is another Energia plant. That's also low solids. That's a dedicated low solids AD facility. And then you have a small facility in San Luis Obispo that's owned by Waste Connections. That's also similar to technology to what we're developing. That was developed a number of years ago. It's been very successful. I don't think it's been profitable for Waste Connections. But it's been a good, successful plant. Part of the reason for that, there's a variety of factors that go into what makes a facility profitable, but it's tipping fee, it's value on the RNG side, and then you also have kind of the size and the kind of economies of scale. So when you do a really small plant that's 30, 40,000 tons, it's very difficult to turn a profit. Even when you go to a 100,000 ton facility, it's difficult to turn a profit. So you really have to go big to get economies of scale to compete with compost. And the project in Escondido is being developed by a local hauler here in San Diego. It's a large private hauler named Edco. It's a 80 to 100,000 ton facility. And the advantage that Edco had as a company is they have a captive audience. So they're a waste hauler that has numerous franchise contracts within San Diego County. So they have built-in feedstock. And so for a waste hauler that has already feedstock built in, it's easy for them to develop a project like this. So this is what one of the diagrams that we've used with legislators in California. We spent a lot of time talking to legislators about the advantage of technology, waste conversion technologies. So at the bottom you have landfill. That's creating all the methane when you deliver material there. Then you've got basic compost. Basic compost is really what we're competing with right now. Basic compost is cheap. It's $40 a ton. It's, you know, on dirt. It's like, you know, manually turning piles is just really the worst technology for dealing with organics. It still emits short-lived climate pollutants. Advanced compost is different. Advanced compost is on aerated static piles, typically a concrete floor. There's aeration. There's different technologies like gore technology where you have gore covers. You have other covers that different other than gore technology, other fabric covers. You also have other material that could be used as cover as well. So advanced compost technology reduces the least amount of short-lived climate pollutants on the compost side. And then you have AD, which is the best technology. EREF just did a study, was published. Brian Staley just released an article here recently. There was a comment about anaerobic digestion really being the best technology for processing organics in terms of releasing the least amount of short-lived climate pollutants when you're processing organics. And the technologies that I just showed you, or the facilities I just showed you, are primarily AD only. They don't have a compost solution on the back end. So the design we've worked many years on is really using high solids AD on the front and then using advanced compost technology on the back end. So now you have a complete solution for processing organics. So I won't spend a lot of time here, but you know, True North, you know, our really business model is to support California in the reduction of short-lived climate pollutants through anaerobic digestion development, as well as producing renewable natural gas. That's the bottom line. So we want to make, you know, produce facilities or develop facilities that decarbonize the pipeline. I think a lot of people here understand what AD is, so I won't spend too much time on talking about what anaerobic digestion is, but essentially it's an oxygen-free environment. It heats the organics up. You use a starter, basically, in the AD, in the high solids AD equipment, and that starter really creates a biologic environment for that material to break down, and then it produces renewable natural gas. Why are the two systems important? Why is it important to combine AD with advanced composting? Well, the reason for that is there's a digestate that comes out of an AD process. So all the other facilities that I showed you produce a digestate, and they have to find some place to take it. Ideally, the best way to process digestate is through a composting process. And some of those facilities I mentioned earlier take that digestate and they send it away from that facility to a composter to utilize in a composting process. Some of them just let it dry out and then they spread it, and farmers may combine it with other materials. But really the best thing to do is to take the digestate as it comes out of the AD and process it through an advanced composting process. And now you have another material that can be utilized and really help with the environment, because really high quality finished compost has a variety of benefits. And that's one of the reasons why we have chosen to locate our facility in Imperial, for example, as was mentioned earlier. And then we also have a facility being developed in Kern. But they're both rural markets. and those rural markets are easy to develop in, but they're also, there's a market for the compost. So I think we talked about this. Everyone understands what organics look like coming out of a landfill. I want to spend a few minutes on what a system design looks like. I think this could be beneficial to everyone here to understand what are some of the components. So, you know, the facility entrance, you have scales as you drive in. We have a pre-processing storage area on number three. That's probably one of the most important aspects of the design is this pre-processing area, because most of the material that's coming in is contaminated. So we're dealing primarily with curbside material, so material that's being generated in a residential collection program. And so that material is gonna have a variety of contaminants, especially if the house, the homeowner, you know, the kid takes the garbage out and he puts it in the wrong bin, it may go in the organics bin versus the commercial bin. That goes to a transfer station before it comes to us, but even when that material goes to a transfer station, the transfer station doesn't have the ability to sort out all of the contaminants. So having a good pre-processing area, and whether no matter what you're developing, if you're developing something to process waste on the organic side of things, you definitely need to have a way to pull out contaminants. We expect somewhere between 5 to 10% of the material coming in is, or 5 to 10% contamination rate of the material coming in, and in some cases as high as 15 to 20, which makes it extremely difficult to be profitable at that. But that is gonna be a reality for some material coming directly in. Number four, we use Dranco high solids digesters. So we went through a rigorous RFP process. We evaluated a variety of high solids AD technologies that are out there, and we chose Dranco because we felt that had the best OPEX and CAPEX for our facility. And then on the number five, we've got the blending and compost finishing. So we've talked quite a bit about that, but we're blending in that digestate. We also blend in pure green waste. So we anticipate that there'll be a lot of green waste that would come into the facility, and that would be used on the blending process to create this very high quality compost. Then the six, you've got the aerated static pile composting system. You've got the air treatment. We're located right next to a gas line in each one of our facilities. So Imperial County does have a great gas line connection available to us. It's one of the reasons why we chose that location. Kern County as well, we're literally right on the gas line in Kern County. So we condition before it goes into the pipeline, but we're injecting directly into the pipeline. That's the design. Number nine is the pipeline injection, and then we've got the admin facility. But that's our overall design. We haven't really shared that in a public format. This is the first time we've shared it because we spent several years designing this. Even though we're not a technology provider, we've put a lot of effort into creating this general design. And we're one of the first companies to really, combine both the high solids AD and the composting on the back end in California, at least. So what are some of the advantages to this design? Well, we can handle a variety of feedstock. So we can handle, unlike a low solids AD, low solids AD can only handle that slurry, so that commercial food waste combined with essentially water. High solids, we can take pure food waste, 100% food waste, 100% green waste, any combination of food and green waste. And we can take, even if there's rendering plants nearby, or especially in like the Kern and Imperial both, there's a lot of farming for cattle, and so there could be potential, meat trimmings coming in, or carcasses, or we can take any type of material, which is great. So it's very flexible. The other thing too is, I didn't mention it earlier with the California regulations, but SB 1383 has a component where cities have to procure RNG or compost. And every city I've spoken to in California, nobody wants to procure compost. They all want to procure RNG. And the RNG has to be derived from organics. So it's got to be, essentially, we call it 1383 RNG because it's derived from an organics process. So that's the other advantage of this facility, is that we can address that procurement requirement from that legislation. So areas of concern. So, you know, the biggest issue that we have as a developer right now is really getting feedstock. And the diversion rate is slow. So there's another Senate Bill 619 called the Laird Bill, and that basically delayed implementation by a couple years. So we see about, I was at a SWANA presentation a couple months ago, and we're like at 50% in California right about now in terms of implementation of 1383. So because we're only at 50%, we're not seeing this like huge influx of organic feedstock. And that's really creating some issues for us as a project developer, because cities and waste haulers are solving the problem right now through what I showed earlier as basic compost. So it's a huge issue. So we're struggling to secure long-term commitments because it's not really a perceived issue. Now, cities in the marketplace see that they need a place to take their material long-term. So they see this as a long-term problem. But I've been in the waste business for 30 years, not as long as Tim has, but I started in the hauling business 30 years ago. And waste haulers, including municipalities, really are looking what's here in front of them. So they're trying to solve problems every day, and they're not looking 10, 15, 20 years out. So that's another challenge, is getting them to see that they need to make commitments now so that we could finance and build the facility. So that's probably one of our biggest challenges. And then, you know, it's an expensive process. It requires equity and debt financing to build a project. These are $200 million projects. So we have put up all of the development money so far, but for us to secure our equity and debt financing, we need to have these feedstock commitments secured. And I think that's the same thing with any waste conversion technology. If you're developing a waste conversion technology facility, you need to secure that feedstock before you could get your financing. So that's it. I was right on time. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer any questions. All right.
Well, thank you very much, Jim. That was very enlightening, what we're doing here in California and otherwise, and with 1383 and the other one that we're talking about. Right now, according to our program, it's time to go into the have a short break, half an hour break, I think it is. Until 10 to 10:30, break in the exhibit hall. I believe there's coffee, water, juices, whatever in there. So let's head on over there. Unless there's some other questions right now. Thank you. It was ringing like crazy. No.